Have you ever found a hidden gem? By that, I mean a show or a movie that for whatever reason gets nowhere near the attention it deserves. I don't mean something like Scott Pilgrim vs. the World, which initially didn't make any money but has since gotten a ton of praise. Or something like In Bruges, which is unknown by many but has a massive cult following. Or even something like Firefly, which was cancelled way too soon but is regarded by many as a classic show.
I mean something that fits into all three of these categories. Something that got no attention when it came out, is unknown by most, and was cancelled far before its time. When I think of gems like these, Moral Oral immediately jumps to mind.
Ooh, Dad!
Shapey, be careful! Don't pull the trigger!
Dada!
Oral, you know the rule. Don't upset your brother until Daddy's had his first highball.
Although I consider Moral Oral to be one of the greatest shows of all time, it's easy to see why it's overlooked. Since it was going to air around Christmas time, Adult Swim made the genius decision of airing the season finale first instead of the pilot, completely missing the entire point of all the character development and slow tone shift of season 1. Also, there were going to originally be 5 seasons. However, after watching season 3 episode Alone, Adult Swim concluded that it was too dark and not only canceled the series, but insisted on airing only 13 episodes instead of the planned 20, which had already been written, forcing the writers to wrap up the series with tons of subplots unresolved. I blame Adult Swim entirely for the series being so underrated.
Maple. Cowboys love maple. Yeah, cowboys.
Moral Oral is an incredibly ambitious TV show created by Dino Stamatopoulos about a 12-year-old boy named Oral Puppington. Oral lives in the town of Moralton, State Zona. The entire first season is about the advice Oral receives from his elders and how he misinterprets it. If it sounds like the premise of a cheesy sitcom from the 50s, that's because it is. The show is intended to have the same atmosphere as corny sitcoms from the 50s such as Leave It to Beaver. The opening theme of Moral Oral is nearly identical to the ending theme of Leave It to Beaver. Whenever there's a scene transition, a few cheery notes play. It's animated by Duke Johnson, who went on to work on Anomalisa, another hidden gem that I strongly recommend. Fun fact, in Anomalisa there's a sex shop called Dino's Toys, named after Dino Stamatopoulos, the creator of Moral Oral. The animation in Moral Oral is cartoonish stop motion juxtaposed by dark comedy and pessimistic themes. An episode that really stands out from season 1 is episode 7, Maturity. The premise of this episode is simply genius. Clay tells Oral that he needs to act more like an adult.
But I'm only 12!
That's no excuse. Why, your own personal hero Jesus was very mature at your age.
He was?
Of course. At 12, he was already busy proving the Jews wrong.
Oral decides to go around observing the adults in Moralton and acting like they do. This causes him to be emotionally distant, depressed, alcoholic, and bitter. It ends with Oral being told by his teacher that he's acting like a child, even though he's acting exactly like the adults in Moralton. It's a hilariously dark episode that pokes fun at the concept of growing up. This is the first episode, if you were watching them in the order that they were intended to be watched in, that hints at a deeper plot. At one point in the episode, we see Oral's parents arguing, and it's not really played for laughs. In fact, it's really uncomfortable. Moral Oral has always explored dark themes, but they've always been played for laughs. In this episode, for the first time, it's portrayed kind of realistically. The season finale of season 1 is absolutely stunning. It starts off by capturing the tone of a Rankin Bass Christmas special, with oversized snowflakes, Christmas bells, a bright title card, and the whole family driving to church together, singing a Christmas carol merrily.
We then find out that the Christmas carol they are singing is actually a commercial jingle, making a subtle jab at the way commercialism has become ingrained in the celebration of Christmas.
If the Lord were alive today, what would you give him this Christmas?
Give him a $20 gift certificate at Pizza Joe's.
Something I love about the opening scene is that if you pay close attention, you can tell that Clay, the person driving the car, is drunk. The car is slightly swerving, his eyes are squinting, and he almost seems ill. The episode suddenly takes a dark turn the night before Christmas when Clay and Orl's mom, Wilberta, start arguing. Here we learn that Shapey, Orl's brother, was in an accident. The scene works really well because it's juxtaposed with Orl cheerily awaiting Christmas. It shows the tragedy of a good kid like Orl being born into an environment that doesn't let him shine. From there, the episode follows the typical moral Orl formula. Orl learns something from an adult and misinterprets it. This time, Orl hears that Shapey's father isn't Clay. This makes him think that Shapey is actually the second coming of Christ. However, the episode has a layer of tragedy that hasn't been seen in moral Orl so far. It really shows the innocence of Orl, and that even through all this hardship, Orl can stay blissfully ignorant. At the end, when Orl is finally confronted with the reality of his parents' failing marriage, it's truly an emotional moment. So much can be expressed through music choice, or lack of music choice in this case.
Boy, God. This sure didn't turn out to be the best Christmas ever. But you still have 2 minutes left, and I have faith in you.
What makes the first season so great is its slow buildup. That's why it's such a goddamn insult that Adult Swim aired the season finale first. The second season mostly stays true to this formula, but it switches it up a bit with more episodes about the townsfolk of Morrilton, sometimes abandoning the comedic tone entirely and delving into a more dramatic tone. Not every episode has a happy ending, with some episodes like The Lord's Prayer, Love, and Courtship ending tragically. It's also a much more plot-driven season. In episode 8, The Lord's Prayer, a family moves in next to Orl. They're exactly like the Puppingtons, except they use a different version of The Lord's Prayer. The episode ends with the family moving out, leaving their 7-year-old son, Block, behind and taking Shapey instead. For the rest of the season, Block is in the household instead of Shapey.
Dad, that's not Shapey.
Orl, you know you shouldn't upset your mother by coming home with dirty clothes.
Although season 2 had a much more depressing tone than season 1, every episode had a comedic focus. That is, until the 2-part season finale nature. Nature is a turning point for the show. This is the first episode that's completely devoid of humor. Similar to the way the pilot sets up the dark comedic tone of the first season, this episode sets up the dramatic tone of the rest of the show. When the episode starts, Clay is spanking Orl. We can hear a slight crackling sound in the background as if a fire were burning, and there is a faint red light on both characters, possibly symbolizing the fires of hell. Clay decides to take Orl on a hunting trip.
But
now what's this?
Oh, that's my favorite lucky shirt.
Favorite?
Yeah. Of all my lucky shirts, this one's the closest to my heart. It's the one I was wearing when I realized that God doesn't love just me, but my whole family as much as me.
All right, just try to keep it out of the way.
Keep this in mind, it's going to come back later. As Orl and Clay travel to the Morrilton Nature Reserve for their hunting trip, we see a large bluebird for the first time. This bird is very important. It can be seen frequently throughout the show. I tried to find out what type of bird it was by listening to its call, however, I was unable to find any bird that resembled its unique sound. I emailed a bird expert, but he said that he couldn't tell what type of bird it was. I've come to the conclusion that this bird is a blue heron, and the call is altered to make it sound more distinct and majestic. This is what a blue heron sounds like. So, yeah, it's easy to see why they changed it. In the Bible, the blue heron is thought of to be unclean and angry. I think that in Moral Orl, the blue heron represents Oral's religion. Throughout the show, Orl learns how to take the lessons he learns from religion and create it into his own ideology, which is frowned upon by the citizens of Morrilton. In the prequel special, Before Orl, the bird appears when Orl learns of God. You can see it pass the car as Clay neglects him. When Orl sees the bird, he's comforted by it. He thinks that even though things are bad, God is watching over him. The mysterious blue heron appears again when Clay tries to get Orl to shoot a rabbit. It reminds Orl that the rabbit is one of God's creatures and he is unable to shoot it. Notice how when we first see the rabbit, there are a few butterflies above it representing Orl's good nature. Something that's particularly great about this episode is its sound editing. The sound of birds calling gets louder and louder in the background as Orl considers shooting a rabbit, building tension. When the rabbit runs away, we again see the butterflies. The butterflies appear again later in the episode when Orl tries to shoot a deer. The butterflies are in between the deer and the gun, meaning that Orl's good nature is preventing him from killing the animal as it is literally and figuratively standing between him and the deer. The only animal that doesn't have butterflies around it is the pheasant, which gets away because Orl drops the gun, not because he decides not to shoot it. Clay grabs the gun from Orl and shoots the deer. After the deer dies, as crows caw in the background, and again they caw when he shoots the dog. I think this is a smart choice because crows are a symbol of death. After Oral and Clay head back to camp, there is a sound of flies buzzing in the background. You can also hear a cougar roaring when Clay goes off on his rant. The title of this episode is Nature, which serves as two meanings. The obvious one is that Clay and Oral go on a trip to be out in nature, and the second one is human nature. The wild animals shown in this episode represent the nature of Clay and Oral. The locusts and flies represent Clay's wicked nature. They appear whenever Clay does something particularly awful. They are seen mostly when Clay is drunk, which makes sense because Wilberta says that when he drinks,
he doesn't change, Oral. That's just his true nature coming out.
And also Clay says that
drunk is nature.
Locusts slowly start to appear on Clay's face the more he gets drunk. Clay mistakenly says that he lives
on the blight side of life.
When he says this, a faint red light is shown on his face, representing the fires of hell. The light gets brighter and brighter throughout the scene. The red light can be seen faintly on Oral's hands as he reaches for his gun. As Oral starts to point the gun at his dad, they both are basked in red light. The blue heron is seen watching over Oral from the treetops. When Oral pulls the trigger, all the birds fly away, and the only sound left are the locusts chirping. The way Oral looks at religion has forever changed. In this moment, Oral has no faith in God. This is the first big moment of defiance we see from Oral, and a huge cliffhanger. Okay, so Oral doesn't actually shoot Clay. He just shoots his alcohol. But the show has been so dark up to this point and such a big change from the tone of season 1 that when I first watched this, I thought they were actually going to kill off Clay. Even though Oral doesn't actually shoot him, I think there was definitely a moment where Oral was thinking about it. In the episode Trigger, which was set before the hunting trip, Clay teaches Oral how to hunt in preparation for the trip. Whenever Oral gets frustrated, he accidentally fires off the gun. It seems like Oral pointed the gun at his father because he was scared for his life and accidentally fired because he was frustrated. In the opening of part 2, we get the typical intro, except for this time, Oral doesn't look up at God like he always does. Instead, he is silently praying. Clay accidentally shoots Oral in the leg. Notice how Oral says,
"I got shot by you,"
instead of, "You shot me." This is to shift the blame away from his dad. Oral needs a tourniquet to stop the wound from bleeding. He has to rip his lucky shirt, which he was originally wearing because
it's the one I was wearing when I realized that God doesn't love just me, but my whole family as much as me.
This is the moment when Oral starts to question whether his family members are good people or not. When Clay goes to sleep, a bear wanders over. Oral is forced to shoot the bear to protect his dad. Clay wakes up covered in locusts, which represent his evil nature, which Oral can now clearly see. Clay asked how Oral was shot, and this time, instead of saying,
"I got shot by you,"
he says,
"You shot me in the leg."
At this point, he has lost all respect for his father.
"Oh, Oral, make me happy. Make me proud of you, son, and tell me that you shot that bear yourself."
"No, Dad. You killed it."
Even when Oral is given the chance to make his dad proud, he turns it down. He is not proud of shooting the bear. It was an incredibly hard thing to do, and he feels terrible about it. The episode ends with a shot of the blue heron looking at Oral through the window. The blue heron is surrounded by flies. Oral's religion has been tainted by the warped lessons his parents teach him. However, a few butterflies pass the window, showing that there is still hope that Oral's good nature will triumph in the end.